Many years ago, the meat industry was much different than it is today in so many ways. A big reason for that is that there wasn't the technology for factory farming, and it wasn't needed, considering that there were approximately only 1 billion people in the world. It was more common than not for people to raise their meat themselves, humanely. But let's take a look at what meat farming is today. Animals are pumped with chemicals to make them grow bigger and faster, starved or fed things that they shouldn't, kept in cramped, small, dirty, disease-ridden, unsafe conditions. And in the end, they are inhumanely slaughtered. And that's just naming the baselines. There are countless different issues, which vary. Now, let's talk about the different animals. There are many issues with factory-farmed cows. Let's get into them. Food. A cow's natural food is grass and other weeds. But for factory farm owners, this is a problem. For one thing, to keep a constant supply of grass, which means that the farm's vast number of cattle would need to be in large areas where they could eat their share of grass every day. To put a cow in that setting for its entire life before slaughter is not only a waste of money, but is also extremely inefficient for factory farm owners. Why feed the cattle their natural food, which makes them grow healthy, organically, and in the right amount of time, when you can feed them genetically altered food, which consists of up to 90% grain, and the other 10%, a mix of chicken feces, feathers, uneaten chicken feed, heavy metals, antibiotics, bacteria, bits of dead rodents, and even bone meal and ground up beef. So yes, they are indirectly eating each other, which they scoop up from the bottom of chicken coops. With this practice, cows can gain between 3 and 4 pounds a day, but serious consequences can come with it as well. It is unhealthy for the cows, who should be eating a strictly grass-only diet. The feed can also spread diseases such as, just to name a few, mad cow disease, E. coli, and other more minor but still serious diseases. Housing. Factory farm cows usually spend the beginning of their lives in grass pastures, which isn't that bad. It's good, actually. But around 6 months into their lives, they are sent to feedlots, where they live in cramped conditions with up to 125 other animals that each have as little as 125 square feet of space to themselves. That might sound like a lot, but imagine being 2,500 pounds in that space, and also spending months in it. They are ankle-deep in manure, which can cause chronic arthritis and other issues if they can't walk on solid ground. The feedlot is also a breeding range for dangerous diseases due to the cows sharing all their food and water from the same place. Cows usually spend 6 months plus in the feedlots and are then sent to slaughter. Cows can live over 35 years, but in this practice, they live a miserable life that barely lasts one. Chemicals. Factory-farmed cows are pumped full of artificial hormones like estrogen, which can rapidly speed growth until they can't support their own weight. They are usually sent to slaughter before it gets that bad, but it is still an inhumane practice which is so commonly used it is deemed regular. Other practices. Cows are branded, marked with their company's logo with an electric iron which burns their skin so the scar will stay there forever. Castrated, not gonna get into that one. And dehorned without painkillers in brutal old-fashioned ways just to save time and money. Transport. Cows are not usually raised near or in their slaughterhouses, meaning that they need to be transported to them. And factory farmers are looking to do this in the cheapest way possible. So they cram up to 45 full-grown cows in an open-topped truck trailer, where they aren't given food, water, or enough room to even lie down in. Their journey can be days long in harsh weather conditions, such as a freezing temperature, which in the animals often get freezed up against the sides of the trailer, and going at up to 60 miles per hour, you can imagine. And then there's weather that is scalding hot, and with no water, the cows often have heat stroke, but are stuck standing up in the truck. There can also be storms and off-road driving, both bad for the animals. Slaughter. Imagine the animals arrive in the slaughterhouse. They have just endured a brutal car ride, and they need to rest. But no. The slaughterhouse workers hop on the truck and prod the animals with electric rods to force them off the truck and onto a conveyor belt. The cows who are unable to move from sickness or exhaustion or injuries are tied up in chains and dragged onto the conveyor belts or pushed on forklifts to them. The conveyor belts then take the animals to the workers, who shoot them in the head with a bullet meant to render them senseless. But oftentimes the workers, many of whom are not experienced, miss or don't shoot the animals correctly, or the bullet guns just don't work properly on the animal, and they are conscious as they are torn apart piece by piece and burnt alive in means to have their hair removed. In the end, they have their throats cut, but can still be conscious after that for up to 7 minutes.
What would I do without your smart mouth? Drawing me in and you kicking me out. You got my head spinning, no kidding. I can't pin you down. What's going on in that beautiful mind? I'm on your magical mystery ride. And I'm so dizzy, don't know what hit me, but I'll be alright. My head's underwater, but I'm breathing fine. You're crazy and I'm out of my mind.
Pigs. I'm not going to talk too much about pigs because they have many of the same injustices as cows have. Housing. Factory farm pigs usually don't see much natural light or breathe much fresh air. They are kept in small cramped pens amongst their and other pigs' manure and filth. But the worst of the worst are gestation crates, which are for the sows. Gestation crates are tiny. For a human, they would be the size of an airline seat. Gestation crates are the living space for the great majority of the sows' lives. They only go out for breeding, and in the end, when they are too old to produce, and are sent to the slaughterhouse. A gestation crate will literally drive a pig insane. All they can do is sway back and forth and gnaw the bars of the crate. Food. You know how pigs will supposedly eat anything? Well, that might just be true. And factory farmers tend to take that to the pig's advantage by either feeding them junk and things that aren't edible for humans, or, brace yourself, their children or others of their own species. Okay, for those of you who say, so what? In the wild, animals eat their own species all the time. But pigs not only make bonds with specific others and are proven to be one of the smartest animals out there, but it wasn't their choice to eat their sisters and their children. When their family and others of their kind die from sickness or lack of just reasonable care, like clean water or safe place to sleep, the factory farmers take advantage and add it to the pig's diet. Chemicals. Pigs are given many of the same chemicals as cows, which are meant to make them grow bigger and stronger. Other practices. Soon after a piglet's birth, they are detailed, castrated, and sometimes even deteethed, in cheap ways without any painkillers. Pigs are also kicked, hit, and beaten by the workers. Transport. Pigs have a very similar with cows in the ways of transport. Slaughter. Slaughter is pretty much the same for pigs as it is for cows.
My lover's got humor. She's the giggle at a funeral. Knows everybody's disapproval. I should've worshipped her sooner. If the heavens ever did speak, she's the last true mouthpiece. Every Sunday's getting more bleak, a fresh poison each week. We were born sick, you heard them say it. My church offers no absolutes. She tells me worship in the bedroom. The only heaven I'll be sent to when I'm alone with
chickens. Housing. Factory farmed meat chickens live in things called feed sheds, which are giant closed barns with rows of feeding and watering containers. Feed sheds can house tens of thousands of crammed chickens. Chickens are not only crammed, but they are literally living in their own waste. There are also no windows or heating, and there is very poor ventilation. The chicks have it pretty bad too, from overcrowding to living in waste. And free-range chickens can be no better than the alternative. It is certified, even if there is a single door barely big enough for one chicken, leading out into a tiny fenced-in dirt lot, which many of the chickens might never even see. Food. Factory-farmed chickens eat a very fattening diet of pure grain, while they should be eating the fiber and vitamins found in wild plants and the protein found in bugs. Chemicals. Factory-farmed chickens are given chemicals to make their desired parts bigger, such as their breasts and their drumsticks. But the additional weight is terrible for the chickens, who now have to spend 90% of their time sitting down, which is much more than chickens not getting chemicals. Their legs often break under the weight
and are left with no way to get to their food and water and slowly have their feathers ripped away to irritated skin underneath from rubbing them on the dirt and fecal so much.
Other practices. Chickens experience everyday abuse from workers, whether it's kicking, being spun around by the legs, or being scared and screamed at. You name it, it happens. Hens may also be de-beaked with a hot iron so they won't peck at each other or themselves, but this is an extremely cruel practice, not only because of the pain, but because of the hens' need for their beaks to easily drink, eat, and groom themselves. Transport. Factory-farmed chickens are sent to slaughter at about only 6 weeks of age, and this is how it's done. First, there's a group of people called the catchers, who sneak into the feed sheds late at night and start grabbing the sleeping birds and either cram or throw them into tiny crates. But once the hens start to awaken, things start to get messy, and the catchers grab hold of anything they can get, whether it's legs, necks, wings, or tails. The crates are then loaded into a truck, which brings them on a terrible drive, possibly with extreme temperatures and bumpy roads.
Slaughter. When the chickens are loaded off the truck, they are chained in leg shackles and hung upside down off of a moving conveyor belt. Then, they are put through an electric bath, which is meant to stun them, but the voltage can be too low, and the chickens make a fast recovery as they go towards the blades, meant to cut their throats. But the chickens that are awake are moving around so much that the blades often don't catch them, and they are then drowned in a scalding bath, which is meant to remove their feathers, alive.
You say, love is what you put into it. You say, that I'm losing my will. Don't you know that you...
Where does meat come from? It comes from animals. But I think the processing of meat has changed quite a bit in recent history. I mean, it used to be you had a cow, you owned a farm, you knew what that cow was eating, or that pig, or that goat, or that sheep. And now we have kind of giant corporate farms, you know, big ag. And so I think there's some mystery around how meat is processed and what is going into the feed for cows. And some stores, some food chains are making it easier for customers to understand that. And there's a kind of a movement of small and local farms getting together in local communities so you can kind of buy a side of beef and you can split it with your friends or your neighbors. So there are some options, but the vast majority of people are getting beef without any understanding of where it's coming from. And I consider myself educated in this area, and I'm not so sure myself.
Okay, I think meat, I've actually been reading a lot about this, and I think meat comes, well, I mean, it's raised, right? And there are different ways that meat is raised. Like, there are a lot of really inhumane ways that depends if you're talking about chicken or beef or whatever, but like raised in super confined quarters, a lot of times the animals can't move around, and then the way that they are harvested is often really inhumane and terrifying too. Plus, so much of our meat in those circumstances is force-fed antibiotics and all sorts of things like growth hormones to make it grow, and then there are people that are trying to break that way of raising meat and go back to the old school way of raising meat, where the free range, and then free range can mean a lot of different things, right? It means maybe there's a little tiny yard for some people, but for others it may mean that the animals actually can move around.
Well, I believe that that cows are bred at various cattle ranches, and that is the place in which they are slaughtered, and then they are probably brought to meat packing stations and then packaged for consumer purchase.
Do I ever feel bad after I eat meat? I'd have to say yes. I don't eat a lot of meat. I think that's why I feel bad sometimes. I'm married to a vegetarian. I'm a very health conscious guy. I actually live by a diet that's actually where I only eat meat in the evenings, if I eat meat at all. I never eat meat before 6 o'clock. That's kind of my rule. And I don't eat it very often. So when I do, because I do love it, I love a hamburger, I love a hot dog, I love a sausage. When I do eat it, because I'm not used to it, I eat very clean, very simple food, I often feel sluggish, I feel guilty, I feel bloated, I don't feel so good. So no, I don't feel well after I eat meat.
Do I ever feel bad about eating meat? I have been thinking so much about this issue, and it's really affected the way I shop and how I cook. My family has not gone vegetarian. There are times I still feel a need for a meat protein, but I cook a lot less meat now, and I buy humanely raised meat. So the time, I feel badly sometimes if I almost never eat beef, but once in a while I crave a steak or something. And I am aware of the impact on the planet, like the environmental impact. And I also know that if I'm eating in a restaurant, they don't, like, some restaurants have bought meat that is humanely raised, but most I'm buying the kind of stuff I wouldn't normally buy. And therefore I'm promoting things that I don't believe in. And yet I'm still doing it. So yes, sometimes I feel badly. And then I also think that a number of humans, I mean, some humans have always been vegetarian, but a number haven't been. And as animals, eating meat can be a part of being an animal. That's maybe how I justify it, but it also feels to me there are times my body really wants meat. So then my job is to be an informed citizen who cares about how what I eat was taken care of. The Aborigine have this ritual as they wander of asking the universe to provide their next meal, and then when that animal comes, then they are thankful to it for it having sustained the cycle of life in its role. I think that's really beautiful, and I'm not that involved. But okay, that's the end of that answer.
I do. I mean, I've heard about different practices, use of hormones and some inhumane practices at cow ranches. And So I actually don't eat a lot of chicken and beef anymore. I actually have been focusing on fish, and fish for the omega-3 fatty acids is pretty healthy anyways.
How do I feel about other countries moving to 100% organic, or in other words, the United States not moving as rapidly or even attempting to be 100% organic in their food, particularly around meat? I'm more interested in food becoming local and understanding where it's actually coming from locally. I think you can have a greater impact on containing what goes into meat, what goes into food, if it's coming from a farm nearby where you know the farmer, you know who raised that cow, you know how they're being fed. The organic label, at least in America, has become quite stretched. Lots of things are organic now. You can get organic Twinkies. And so what does that really mean? I think the organic label, at least in America, is not something that I feel strongly that we have to strive for. It's more understanding what is hormone-free, what is pesticide-free, where it's coming from, is it local? Then you think you have more of a chance of getting something that is natural and healthy and not full of toxins.
So I think it's great that some countries are doing that. I suspect that we aren't, because we have created such a huge meat culture. Like, if you go California is different. At least our pocket of California is different. Probably the LA pocket of California is different, and people often eat smaller quantities. But if you go into a lot of the country, the size of a good meal, I mean, the size of a meal makes people feel like they've had a good meal. So if they have a huge steak, they think they've had a fancy meal. Or if they, so there's something very American about having a big piece of beef, which somehow we have to change our national identity, right? Like fewer people smoke. So somehow we need to change the way Americans think about eating meat. But it's really, I don't know why we aren't able to make that shift more easily. It's like the things that tie into people's identity, like with the rhinos or, oh, I don't know, you could name almost anything. But you would think with how educated our country is that we would be able to eat less meat. But I know people who eat big amounts of meat every day and they don't think about how it's raised and they don't want to. I think a lot of Americans, and this is probably human nature, but look away from things that make them uncomfortable and just sort of toodle along. And then eventually the noise gets big enough and then they think about it. Or they meet someone, like they have a family member who cares a lot and educates them. But it's often that personal contact that makes a difference.